Labor Day. It's time to get outdoors and make your holiday weekend one to remember. And there's no better place to get ready than Cabela's. Get 30% off all Cabela's camp kitchens, furniture, and cots. $100 off a Ruger American Bolt Action Rifle with Vortex Scope Combo after sale and mail-in rebate. 15% off all in-stock canoes and kayaks. And $20 off Winchester USA bulk handgun ammo. Hurry in and gear up for Labor Day weekend at Cabela's.
Hello, and welcome to the Bee in Eden radio show. I am your host, the Queen Bee herself, Sedona Deb. And as you might have guessed, I am speaking to you from a location near Sedona, Arizona, which lately has been a land of drenching monsoons and dazzling displays of thunder and lightning. But we have a pretty day today and an interesting topic to consider. For myself, we bees are keenly aware of the changing of the seasons, and our summer monsoon season will be wrapping up as this month of August draws to a close. And by the way, the beautiful soundbite you heard at the beginning of the show with the buzzing bees and the nature sounds is a file that's available at the website of www.ambientmixer.com, and that ambient mixer is spelled with a hyphen in the middle. And we like to use it to introduce the busy buzzing of all the information we have to discuss. The sacred seventh month of the year, September, is bearing down on us. And yes, you heard that right. I did refer to September as the seventh month, not the ninth month. And I'll explain why I say that and how this relates to the focus and goals of this new show, A Bee in Eden. Now, here's a bit of trivia you can use to start a dinner conversation. Let's think about the very word September. Why is September called September? Curiously, the prefix S-E-P-T refers to the number 7. Now, why does our silly English language choose to name this month with a word that means 7, even though on the calendar we call it the ninth month of the year? And the calendar makers didn't just do that to the month of September. They did it to October, to November, and even December. All of those prefixes of those 3 months refer to the numbers 8, 9, and 10. Now, why are we doing such a crazy thing to our calendar? You see, in the ancient world, communities were primarily organized around their agricultural or farming cycles. Therefore, springtime was really seen as the beginning of their year. That was when you could plant your seeds or when the grapevines began to bud out. So if you begin your calendar with the month of March, then September becomes the proper seventh month of the year, not the ninth month. Why do we bring up this curiosity of how the months of our year are out of whack with how they are named? Does it really matter what you call them? Well, we mention it because on this show, we will be talking about the history of money and money lending. There are certain traditions and protocols that are being used today that got their start way back in history, back when the entire economy of a nation revolved around the all-important seasons of planting and harvesting. And those traditions are still sort of encoded into the way the months of the calendar are named. It's as if those traditions are still hidden, like a code in those names. When we come back from our first break, we're going to talk about Egypt, her temples, and the relationship these held with a king known today as the Silver Pharaoh. Those temples became very powerful because that's where the people brought their harvest. It's where the whole treasury of the city was stored. But when a handful of unscrupulous priests began twisting the natural laws of mathematics, things began to go horribly wrong, and we still suffer today because of it. So sit back and think about those concepts, and we'll be back in just a couple of minutes.
What if you got rewarded for every good decision? What if your heart had a special way of letting you know it appreciates your healthy choices?
I've got to get my family to eat more vegetables.
Amazing!
And instead of cooking with butter tonight, I think I'll saute our veggies with a heart-healthy oil.
You're a genius!
So really, would your food choices pay off in heart health? Did you know that when you replace bad fats with healthier fats, like those in canola or other vegetable oils, it can lower bad cholesterol levels, and that's good for your heart. Here's a winning idea. Take up the challenge for good health, because the you of the future will say,
fantastic!
Learn more at heart.org/facethefats. Canola Info proudly supports the American Heart Association's Face the Fats campaign.
And we're back. On our previous show, I made a statement that I promised to explain further. I had said that during all human history, the gold and silver mines were owned by tight networks of family businesses. So these elite families had a lot of power over other nations' entire monetary systems because they were the families who provided the gold and silver bullion that everybody wanted to use as pieces of money as a swap exchange system for their harvest crops. And in our last show, we explained how agents of the temple would be sent out with letters of credit in their hand, sent to distant lands to do business with agents of those temples. Those letters of credit worked sort of like a giant credit card and would be accepted by the agents of the foreign temple as a guarantee of future payment for gold and silver, bullion, or whatever else that the foreign temple would now export back to the home territory. So this flow of trade and credit and money creation was really in the hands of the temples, their agents, and these family networks who had their hands in everything. The kings were really just the puppets of these networks. As further proof of that point, I'd like to share something I learned from a PBS documentary about a king of Egypt who is known as the Silver Pharaoh. We have a link to this documentary and some other visuals at our show page. By the way, you can review the script of our shows and even post comments to me through the links on the page that lead you to my home blog of Sedona Deb, or just Google search the word Sedona Deb blog and you'll come straight to it. The real name of this silver pharaoh of Egypt was Susesenes I. He lived about 1,000 years before Christ. He was called the silver pharaoh because he's the only pharaoh we know of who was buried in an all-silver coffin instead of a gold one. Now, here is a portion of the transcript from this PBS show that I found very interesting. It says, "The trouble began here in Thebes. The only figure powerful enough to challenge a pharaoh was Egypt's high priest, who was in charge of the vast temple of Karnak. In some ways, the term high priest is a bit misleading because he was more than just a religious official. And notice this point. He ran a big business, temple was. He was an important political leader, and he could even command military might. Kings, to win their favor, that is the favor of the priests, would give them rights to fishing and fowling and hunting, or rights to the mines, or even rights to trade along the Nile. And so the priest would gain increasing amounts of wealth. They were just getting wealthier and wealthier as time went on, until they eventually decided, hey, why don't we become king? Well, shortly before Susenes' reign began, the high priests made their play for power. As the priests asserted their authority, Egypt was riven in two, and 5 centuries of chaos would follow. The high priest seized the south of Egypt, and the pharaoh was exiled to the frontier region up in the northern delta. Now, that's the end of the quote from the transcript of that show that I wanted to mention. Did you notice that the kings eventually began giving away all this wealth and rights to do trade and exploit the mines to the temple priesthood? The temples were really in charge of the economic direction of the whole nation. They were the original bankers and moneylenders. And I'd like to remind the audience again of why we are talking about this ancient history. The slogan of this show, A Bee in Eden, is this: anticipating our future by remembering our past. There are billions of people today who long to be free of the perpetual debt slavery they are trapped in. At the very least, even people in the wealthy United States recognize that something has gone horribly wrong in a nation for it to be buried under $20 trillion in national debt, even though the country is full of abundance. And people want to know why this keeps happening. And the only way to answer that question is by examining where did it all get started. At this time, I'd like to mention a few points from one of my favorite books, that book I've referred to before, entitled Babylon's Banksters by Joseph P. Farrell. On page 168, he describes the cruel, miserable working conditions of slaves who were consigned to the gold mines. Gold mine extraction required vast amounts of slave labor, and the slaves did not live very long. So it's no wonder that armies were constantly going to war with each other to capture more slaves. In fact, really, it was the needed labor for the gold mines that really prompted much of man's early slavery trade altogether. I'm reaching for my book over here, and I'm going to open it to page 168, and this is the quote. "The mines are guarded by mercenary soldiers of various barbarous nations whose language is foreign to them and to each other, so that there are no means either of forming conspiracies or of corrupting those who are set to watch them." And then Dr. Farrell makes this point near the end of the page for why these people were hiring foreign mercenaries who spoke different languages. He says it was to deny the condemned any opportunity of bribing a sufficient contingent of guards to effect an escape. Now, let's think about what that implies. That was quite clever of these family networks who own the mines. What he's saying is that there was an international cartel that managed the gold mines, and they figured that they would always be able to prevent the guards from launching some kind of revolution or takeover of the mine if none of the guards could speak each other's language. And furthermore, people who were working in the mines spoke different languages too, so nobody could ever get together and put an end to the power of the families who owned the mines. Now, that also implies that the people who owned the mines were surely able to communicate with each other. You can imagine them forming this big secret trade agreement amongst themselves to swap different mercenary staff armies who were not able to speak each other's language. Well, we're going to take a break here, and when we come back, I'd like to show you the scheme these people came up with that turned them into money magicians. It has something to do with what we today would call fractional reserve lending, but the practice was so deceitful that some ancient kings, like King Hammurabi of ancient Babylon, tried to make it a capital offense if you used it in business. Think about that. An actual law passed that would send corrupt, greedy bankers to the guillotine if they broke the law. Well, we'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Whoa, a digital music player. Thanks, Mom.
Glad you like it. We can finally toss out that old massive stereo.
Mom, you can't just throw out electronics. They need to be recycled or donated.
Recycled? Like aluminum cans?
Yeah. You just go to greenergadgets.org, enter your zip code, and it tells you where the nearest certified recycling center is.
I knew that.
Okay, Mom.
Recycling electronics is as easy as buying them. Log on to greenergadgets.org to find electronics recycling options near you.
Welcome back to the show. So what have we learned so far today in our conversation? We have seen that there was an international scope to the operations of the gold mines because those owners deliberately placed guards who spoke foreign languages as overseers of the mines. That prevented anybody from launching any kind of a revolution and breaking out of the mine. We saw also that temple priesthoods had control over the royal treasuries and would even be given rights to the product of the gold mines. So already we can see the potential for the temple priesthoods to maintain a close association with the families who ran those mines. But these priesthoods, these money magicians, as I like to call them, use their knowledge of math to come up with ways to create wealth out of thin air that went beyond the physical pile of gold and silver pieces in their vaults. That author, Dr. Farrell, outlines the four stages of their scheme on page 202 of the book Babylon's Banksters. And you're going to see that the bankers today are using this same formula. Here are the four stages to their scheme. Stage number one, penetrate and ally yourselves with the temple. Stage number two, issue false receipts. Stage number three, substitute the gold and silver with letters of credit backed up by those false receipts. And stage number four, create a facsimile of money or phony money. Now, stage number one is something we've discussed here before. The temple was the place where people brought their harvest. So you have this pile of real, actual, physical goods coming into the temple and to the marketplace that operated around the temple. Stage number two, the issuing of false receipts, is related to what we today would call fractional reserve lending. The people would exchange their harvest at the marketplace for equivalent pieces of gold and silver. And that's proper. There's nothing wrong with that. You simply sell your crop and receive a piece of metal for it. There's no fraud in that necessarily. But maybe you don't need to use those gold and silver pieces right away to buy anything just yet. Maybe you just need a safe place to store them. So what do? You go to the temple and offer to place it with on deposit at the temple. And why would you do this? Because the temple was the most secure building of the community, and it was guarded by the king's armies. Now, the agents of the temple, the scribes, would gladly give the depositor a receipt for that deposit. And they did this on a small clay tablet. It was something you could actually walk around with and put in a pocket. The depositors soon figured out that it became easier for them to buy other goods in the marketplace simply by exchanging their clay tablet receipts with one another rather than running back to the temple to withdraw their gold pieces every time they needed to go buy something at the marketplace. And this is exactly what the scribes at the temple wanted their depositors to do. Just leave your stuff with us, and we'll keep it safe, and we'll just keep issuing these receipts for whatever's on deposit. But then these bankers did something dishonest, and it is still done today, and what's worse, it's even perfectly legal. Since the depositors would take a long time before they came back to withdraw their actual gold pieces, the scribes figured out that they could just keep issuing more receipts against the same deposit. Today, that's what is called fractional reserve lending. This is how it works. When you deposit, say, $1,000 into a long-term savings account at a bank, the bank gives you a receipt, and the banker tells you the money is safe and you can come and collect it anytime you like. But he knows in actual practice you won't really be back for, say, a year. Meanwhile, the banker lends out, say, part of your deposit, say only 900 of your money, to some other person, and he tells that person to pay it back in 6 months. That way he can borrow from your little account, lend it to someone else on interest, and get that money back into your account before you come back to collect it. Now, what does that other person do with this $900? He goes and, say, buys a car with it. Then he gives that money to the car dealer, who now has $900 in his pocket. So he's got that money in his pocket, but you still have your receipt in your pocket for the original $1,000. Then what does the car dealer do with that? Well, he takes his $900 to his own bank and deposits it with that banker. And then the second banker does the same thing that the first banker did. He lends out, say, $800 of the car dealer's money to some other guy, and the whole process begins all over again. Meanwhile, you and that car dealer are holding two receipts that are tied to that one original first deposit of $1,000. Now, already, you're probably thinking, well, this does seem a little bit shady, but maybe nobody really gets hurt as long as everyone who's borrowed the money is willing to keep making their payments, right? But do you see really what just happened? The first banker created extra money out of thin air, simply by creating credit. The only real money in the transaction was your original $1,000. The car dealer now has his own magical receipt for $900, but that's backed up by your savings account receipt, which is not owned by him. So really, his $900 is backed up by nothing. The whole thing is just a big fraud. And then it gets worse because the second banker repeats the whole process with some other customer. So essentially, the whole thing just gets blown out of proportion as a big Ponzi scheme. And the scheme works for a while until suddenly the true laws of math take over like a game of musical chairs. The guy at the top of the pyramid finally comes back to the bank to collect his savings account, or the people who are supposed to be making their loan payments suddenly fall into economic hard times and can't make the payment, and the whole network of fraud collapses. Now, back in the days of Babylon, these agents of the temple weren't just doing this at their local community level. See, they were keeping track of all this magical money that they put into circulation. On their books, it looked like there was a lot of money available in their reserves. So when they would send their traveling merchants out to distant lands empowered with these letters of credit, those letters reflected the great reserves of phony money back at the home temple. But the temple agents at the foreign temple could then take those letters of credit and use them as a basis to start their own Ponzi scheme in their own land. And so it goes over and over. But eventually the music stops and everybody scrambles for a chair. In the city of Ur, that's exactly what happened. Drowning in debt and no longer able to pay for the defense of the city, the mighty city of Ur succumbed to the onslaught of the invading Elamites, a neighboring tribe who pretty much showed up one day to collect on a debt. And don't be too surprised if the same thing happens soon to the mighty empires of our day, who have been used to getting what they want by issuing lots of debt built on phony money. Sadly, the only people who suffer in these upheavals are the common folk and the kings. The temple priesthood and their traveling merchants just skulk away back into the shadows, ready to start the process all over again with the new incoming empire. Well, my fellow bees, the clock tells us it's time to return to the beehive. When we venture out next time, we will pick up with that story of the magic money and talk about a real family of moneylenders who were brought to ancient Babylon as captives, but they knew how to work the system so well that they eventually were able to decide what kings to remove and what kings to sit on the throne of the mighty Persian Empire. That family was called the Murasu family, and I once wrote a historical fictional tale about them. You can preview this on the Sedona Deb blog as a homework assignment for your next visit, if you like. Well, I would like to thank the audience for paying attention to this information because it is important information, and many thanks also to our sponsors who make the show possible. This is the Queen Bee, Sedona Deb, buzzing off until our next chat.
More than 1 million wild animals are killed each year illegally. Poaching is a major threat to our country's wildlife. I'm Tom Barry. I'm an actor with a desire to preserve living space for wildlife. The Humane Society Wildlife Land Trust does just that. Works with private landowners to protect wildlife, to preserve natural habitats. To learn more or to work with the Humane Society Wildlife Land Trust, call 800-729-SAVE. That's 800-729-SAVE or visit wildlifelandtrust.org. Thank you. Thank you.
That's what my unpredictable hair sounded like before Frizzies. Sound familiar? We'll stop the crunchiness and celebrate your curls with Frizz-Ease Air Dry Waves. It gives you defined, touchable waves with soft, feather-light movement. No heat required and no frizz. And that's the sound you'll hear and feel with your defined, touchable waves from Frizz-Ease. Frizz-Ease Air Dry Waves, only from John Frieda.
Stop by your friendly neighborhood Albertsons and get great deals on family favorites for a fun Labor Day celebration. You'll find fresher meats for the grill and fresher produce everyone loves. Get USDA Choice Ribeye Steaks Bone-In Value Pack for just $5.97 a pound. Premium Red Seedless Grapes for just 99 cents a pound. And pick up 12 packs of Coca-Cola, Pepsi, or 7-Up, four for $11 when you buy four. Fresher choices, sweeter deals, better gatherings. Albertsons, it's just better.